She, as a prolific writer, she is providing incisive analysis of social media, social trends and legal reforms, including domestic violence, minority law reforms, secularism, human rights, significant among her own publications as her autobiography, My Story, a story of rebuilding broken lives, which has translated into several languages from English. Her more recent engagement has been with issues of democracy, secularism, and identity politics. It is indeed our humble privilege and honor for us to listen today and learn from ma'am. And on behalf of the entire team and on behalf of the participants, I welcome you, ma'am, to the session. Without any further delay, we hereby request you, ma'am, to kindly take over. Thank you.
Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, you are audible now.
Okay, you can hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Okay. Thank you, Kevin, and thank you for this entire group for inviting me for this session to share our experiences of providing social legal support to rape survivors. I've been part of the women's movement since in fact the movement started here, and one of our key issues has been the issue of sexual assault and rape. We started with this issue, and this has been a consistent thread. Violence against women becomes a consistent thread that has gone along for the last 40 years, and the women's movement has responded in two ways. One is to ask for law reform with a premise that if there is a better law, then it will act as a deterrent. And among the realm of law reform, the most prominent of it is stringent punishment. So if there is stringent punishment, there is a belief that it will act as a deterrent and the cases will come down. But this has not actually played out on the ground. Each time, as you can see, there is a important case that attracts media attention, like the Nirbhaya case, like the Hathras case, etc., like the Kathua rape case. There's always, it accompanies with firstly a demand and then a response from the state for changing the law. So we started in 1980 with the Mathura rape case. This happened in Maharashtra. A 16-year-old girl was raped by policemen on duty. And the Sessions Court acquitted the accused on the ground that she has not resisted because there were no marks of injury on her body. If you resist, then there will be injury to your body. If there are no injuries, that means you have consented. Now, this girl was called for interrogation in the police station. She was a 16-year-old. She was tribal. She was illiterate. She was poor. She was orphan. You can think of every kind of disadvantage or marginalized situation you can perceive was there in this girl. But for this reason, that she had eloped with her boyfriend, the judges believed that she's not worthy of the remedy which law provides, or she's not worthy of justice because she's not a good woman. She is has eloped with somebody. There were no marks of injury. So that is how judges thought about women and their sexuality. So when they acquitted the policeman, the case went to higher court. The state, in fact, went on appeal to the High Court of Bombay High Court in Nagpur. And the High Court reversed the order and convicted the two policemen. Against this conviction, the accused went to the Supreme Court. See, interestingly, Supreme Court reversed the High Court judgment, upheld the Sessions Court judgment, agreed with the Sessions Court that Mathura is a liar, she has made up this whole case, she must have actually enjoyed this sexual intercourse, it was not rape, she has no injury. Now, this was a shocking judgment from the Supreme Court, which was taken up by four law teachers of the Indian Social Institute, Professor Upendra Bakshi being one of them, from the entire Indian Social Institute, Indian Law Institute, only four were ready to sign it, and it was sent to the Chief Justice, that asking for a review. But it was an open letter, and it came out in all newspapers, and generally people were shocked, particularly those into the civil liberty movement. Particularly women in this civil liberty movement felt it very personal, that they felt, how can the Supreme Court think like this about women? And when they asked for a review, the Supreme Court responded saying, we don't make laws. Your struggle should be for law reform. Go before the legislature, go before the government, don't come before us. With that started the entire campaign for law reform. And in 1983, we got the law amendment, rape law reform amendment, which was remained unchanged for over 100 years since IPC was enacted in 1860. We're talking about 1983. So the main aim was that a custodial rape became a special offense. A minimum punishment for rape was prescribed, minimum being 7 years for all rapes and 10 years for aggravated rape.
Ma'am, you're muted. We can't hear, ma'am. Ma'am, your audio is muted. Ma'am.
Hello?
Yeah, now we can hear, ma'am.
Okay. So there are so now after this reform came into effect, there was a general feeling that now things will improve. But if we really looked at the statistics from 1983 onwards, you will see a steady incline. The number of cases being reported each year went up. So now here we are till the Nirbhaya case, which again came into the highlight in 2012. So in this, from 1983 to 2012, what has happened? How did this law actually pan out? Whether courts giving this mandatory 7 years or 10 years in custodial rape, did it act as a deterrent? In fact, nobody was monitoring the actual happenings in a trial court. What exactly happens? That victim's dignity should not be violated, her privacy should be maintained, various kinds of provisions were there. But nobody bothered about actually monitoring them. Only when a case like this comes out, then there were campaigns, there were protests, etc. But a systematic monitoring and systematic research in any one court also did not take place. And that is the sad thing. So again in the 2012 demand for rape law, which came into effect in 2013, a similar format was used. And again, increase in punishment, more stringent, the law is executed. After all this, we get now in 2020, Hathras rape case, where the caste becomes a very important issue. The state becomes complicit with the rapists because of the social marginalization of this victim. If you see, even Mathura was a tribal girl, poor tribal girl. Nirbhaya was not, but many other important rape cases were all either they were Muslim women, or they were tribal women, or they were Dalit women. And these cases had come out in a very in the public domain, and women's groups had worked on these particular cases. So when Majlis started in 1990, we started doing a lot of research on rape law and judgments that were coming out. And it was quite shocking to see, though there was mandatory minimum punishment in the statute, most of the judges were not aware of it. They were giving 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, sometimes even like for one day, etc. So that provision of mandatory minimum punishment had become a mockery, and the deterrent effect actually was not there. So now came the next question, that what is required? Why these cases end up in acquittal? Our conviction rate is about 25%. So 75% of the cases that are actually reported, at the end of it, the accused get acquitted and the girl is projected as a liar, that it is a false case. So that was our concern in Majlis, that we said, why are these cases happening like this? What is required to plug that gap from the FIR to the trial stage? You have this girl to depose in a way that we can secure conviction. And that is the gap we try to fill in Majlis through our Rahat program, which started in 2011. It started in 2011 because close to the vicinity of our office in the school, a four-year-old girl was raped by the school watchman. And a complaint was filed, but there were so many news reports that were coming that this woman is asking for money. She has filed this false case. There was no such case. There was no such incident, etc. Though the medical reports revealed that there is injury to the hymen stone, that she was bleeding, there was injury. But the police were not even ready to record an FIR. There's no medical report done, and the mother had to run pillar to post to get it. So then we realized that what a Herculean task for this woman to prove this in court. What kind of help does she require? So we made efforts to locate this lady and her daughter. We went and told them that we would support them. And that's how we learned the criminal law, actually, because earlier we dealt mainly with issues like domestic violence, matrimonial law, divorce, custody of children, maintenance, etc. Most of them are civil issues. We had not actually entered the domain of the criminal law. But we decided that, yes, this is a very important area. Law reform is not enough. The demand for a law reform is not enough. Securing a law reform is not enough. We have to actually see how the judges are using this in the court. And if there are any lapses, we have to highlight them. So we had to work through various mechanisms within the criminal justice system, like the police, like the courts, like the prosecutor, the actual trial, etc. And it's very unglamorous work. It goes on for a long period of time. The victim, the survivor, may need many different kinds of support. And if nobody is there for her as a support person, it is highly unlikely that her parents will compromise the case. They may accept money from the accused. They will ask this girl not to say it was forced and police have filed false case, etc. So how do we stop this from happening? So this was a concern. So slowly as we went along the way, we realized that there are so many issues which are not strictly legal, you can call them social, that somebody needs to be with the girl to help her family to overcome it. For instance, the girl may be pregnant. The girl may have contracted some venereal disease. Maybe she's not able to go back to the same school because of the stigma. Maybe the family is not able to reside in the same locality because of the stigma that is caused. There's so many other issues that are connected. The state has promised certain compensation, but her parents do not know how to avail of it. She doesn't know how to avail of it, and nobody tells her how to avail of it. So all these issues came before us. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear.
Okay, I'll continue because here I can't see myself. Okay, doesn't matter. Then there are issues like this girl needs a shelter home because the accused is in the neighborhood. Maybe the accused person is her own family member, like a father or uncle. So then she needs to be shifted to a safer place, like a government shelter home, something like that. So these were kind of issues that a child has to be produced before the child welfare committee to ascertain. She has to be produced before a magistrate so that her evidence is recorded by a magistrate. There are several legal steps. Maybe the medical examination was not done accurately. Maybe there are certain gaps there in the medical examination which will go against her in the trial. So at each stage, we needed to like look at the documents, meet the family, meet the girl, give her the support, and also explain to her what is a trial, what exactly happens in a trial, and what is expected of her in a trial. So this is how we started our program. And we learned along the way, and we realized that with this kind of support, the conviction rate was up much higher than what is the general conviction rate, like up to about 70%. And that came as a shock. So we were not there to secure conviction. We were clearly there only to offer support to the victim. But in the process of providing the support, we were able to change the percentage of convictions, and that was a huge gain of the project. We also felt that we needed to support the public prosecutor. We have to work along with the police, point out where they have not done as per the law, and bring it to their notice and attend to it. Where the medical has not done their duty, where the police have not done their duty, where the prosecutor has not done their duty. And one of the main things we do is to provide the legal research and the case law for the prosecutor to submit to the court, so that the point that we are making is supported by case law. That is very important. And usually public prosecutors are not well versed with case law research. They don't have the time for it. So at each stage, they welcomed our additional support, because of which we were able to change the conviction rate. And more importantly, our aim was to make the child comfortable. Because what happens otherwise is that a case is filed, a FIR is filed. It is written in a language of the state, which may not be the language which the child knows. It is read out and explained to her, which she may understand or may not understand. She may be 5 years, she may be 10 years, she may be 15 years, she may be literate, she may be illiterate. Her education may be a very basic level. So how will she know exactly what has been recorded? And that also about a year ago or 2 years ago. then there is no contact of the police with the victim at all. Medical is done, statement is recorded, statement by the magistrate is recorded, and there the matter lies. Then the case goes on in the court, and it is committed for sessions trial. And at the sessions, the trial takes place much later. And one fine day, the police land up at a place and tell the family that tomorrow she will have to come to court. Court number so and so, please be present at 11 o'clock. They have no idea what is going to happen in the court at all. What has transpired in these 2 years regarding the case, she has no idea. She has never seen a courtroom. She has never met a judge or a prosecutor, or she has never seen so many police, as you see in the sessions court. So sometimes the children cry there only at the where the checking happens, and they don't want to enter that space which is surrounded by all policemen, without realizing the policemen are there for her support. So we take the child to the court so that the child sees the structure. The child sees what the courtroom where the trial is going to take place, where the judge sits, who is the prosecutor, what is the prosecutor to her, what is a defense lawyer, where she would have to stand, what kind of questions she would be put. So we do a sort of a mock trial. That is what makes her comfortable when she enters the court for the hearing, for the cross-examination. We also tell her that under the law, you have a right to tell the judge if you have not understood a question, to repeat. You can tell the judge that you're tired, you need to drink water, you need to sit, you need a break, or like you feel like fainting, so you need to eat something. All these are rights that are put in the law for the child. But we have not paid any attention to it. The public prosecutor does not explain anything to her. And she's treated as the accused person, rather than somebody who needs support and sympathy and compassion while she's giving evidence in the court. So the judges, to ensure that cross-examination is not done in a very aggressive manner, in a very confusing manner, it is to be done in a way that the child understands what is the question. It cannot be like a very confusing sort of question to trick her to give a wrong type of answer. So all these things the judge has to take care. But when the judge doesn't take care, the public prosecutor has to point it out. But we realize neither the public prosecutor pays attention, nor the judge attends to this. So who will do it? So our role, by being a support person in the court, we're not the lawyers. We're not the lawyers for her. We don't file a wakalatnama. We don't file her appearances. But we are there all the time for her as a socio-legal support, understanding the law very well, understanding the case law on that particular issue very well, and providing a support to the judge and the public prosecutor by being there in present and making the child comfortable while she's answering these questions. Because if she's not comfortable, she will give wrong answers. By being there and being support to the parents of the girl, we also minimize the issues of collusion. We or the retraction that happens, the pressure on the girl exerted by her own parents. So we become a shield for her so that the case proceeds in a way that her dignity is maintained, in a way that she is able to tell the truth, providing a level playing ground for the child during the. That has been our role. And we feel it's a kind of a unique model. When we started it, there were not many people who were doing it. Nowadays, there are a few more instances. Like in Delhi, there is some groups who are providing this kind of support. In Bangalore, we see some groups providing this kind of support. Some groups in Bombay also providing this kind of support. So here, the most important thing is to see that the child is not, that doesn't break down. the child is sustained and sticks to her initial statement through this gap of 2 years, the child is familiar with her FIR, what the police have recorded at that time, so that when questions are asked to her, she does not get baffled or confused. And that is where conviction will take place. Otherwise, conviction cannot take place. We cannot blame the judges. We cannot blame the prosecutor. We cannot blame the police or the medical officers. But it is a system as a whole that ensures that justice is not done for this child. So it's not just the victim and her parents that need support. We also realize that the medical fraternity, the doctors who have examined the child, even they get very scared to come to court. Even the investigating officer is very scared to give evidence in the court. There are many, like at different stages, the one who has recorded the FIR, the investigating officer, the one who collected the blood samples from the hospital and taken it to the forensic this laboratory. Now all these, you have to complete the chain of events. You have to complete the entire circle from where actually the evidence traveled. And for that, you need to examine so many people. Sometimes the public prosecutor is indifferent. Does not ask the relevant question. What needs to be asked? And these gaps are exploited by the defense lawyers. But defense lawyers, they're very alert as against the haphazard way a public prosecutor goes through this process. So if we are there, then we are able to point out these lacuna, bring it to the notice of the judge. And if the judge has not conducted the trial as prescribed by the law, then there is nobody to monitor, there is nobody to supervise what the judge is doing. He passed the law saying that judge must do this, judge must do this. Judge is not doing. Who is the authority that will ensure that the judge is done or judge is held up for not doing a particular adhering to a particular provision in law? We don't have any of these mechanisms. We don't have any of this. So if we are there, and we are there with the permission of the High Court, we are there with the permission of the police commissioner, then we have a certain authority, then we have a certain place to be, or that value for our presence over there. And we can then write to the Chief Justice, mentioning the case number, mentioning the date on which this happened, and where the judge actually violated a law, a provision in law, or a police officer violated a provision of law, or a medical officer did not follow the prescribed procedure for examining a rape victim. Only when this is done, there's certain fear that gets introduced into the system, where everybody is on their toes and they're a bit more alert, saying that, you know, that unless we do this, there's somebody like watching over us. Because this, today the system has nothing. Our only response has been increased punishment, increased punishment, increased punishment. We have not examined the criminal legal structure in a very, very detailed manner. Looked at all the gaps that can happen. And most important, what kind of support this child needs, this woman needs, as she goes through this very rigorous, very daunting technical legal procedure. So having done this, we have produced a report, we have sent it to the High Court, and we can see a lot of improvements. We can see, the child is to be brought there, and the accused is to be brought there, and both had to sit on the same bench till the matter is called out outside the court. And imagine what fear the child will have, what fear the parents will have, just before the she's called out to give evidence. But now we have ensured that the child does not meet the accused person. She's kept in a different room till she's called out to give her evidence. That there is some time for the public prosecutor to meet the child and to explain to the child what's going to happen in the court. Now, all these very small measures, they're not very big measures. but they will ensure that the litigation actually happens in a fair manner, where the child is given provided with a level playing ground, so that the criminal trial is impartial, the criminal trial is fair, and it's not one-sided, and where the child has certain opportunity to prove her case that she is not a liar, that she has reported the case not falsely, and that it meets the requirement of the criminal law. So this is the program that we do. So far we have, from 2011 till now, we have reached out to more than 1,000 victims, walk the legal journey, and to help them to become survivors. But they don't become survivors only by changing the nomenclature to say, no, now we'll not call her victim, we call her a survivor. But she's alive. But sometimes she's not alive. In the case of Nirbhay, she's not there. In the case of Hathras, she's not alive. And we still call them survivors, but they didn't survive. Next year of the rape, you wake up and you call yourself survivor. That cannot be. To become a survivor is a process. That step by step, you walk the legal journey. And when you finish walking this journey, you become familiar with the medical procedure, with the police procedure, with the court procedure, and finally you are able to come to the end of the trial. And if you are able to get a conviction, so that journey itself becomes very empowering. And at the end, we can say she is now a survivor. She has survived this ordeal, not only of the rape, but of the criminal trial. And she has been able to prove the case and get a favorable judgment. So that is our aim, that is our motto. That favorable judgment is lesser important. That this journey should be an empowering journey for her. It should not push her down further into the abyss that she has fallen. Somewhere she needs help to emerge from it as victorious, so that she is able to cope with life there onwards. So that is our aim. And with that, I feel this innovative scheme has got certain recognition, and many of our junior lawyers are very aptly familiarize themselves with the criminal legal process. They understand the system. They know where the support is required and what kind of support is required, and are able to cross this ordeal with the girl, with the victim, alongside with the victim, her family members, etc., and see that that we provide support not just for the victim but the entire family, because the entire family suffers in this process. So unless they know that there is somebody for them, some person who will help to negotiate all the different legal mechanisms, it is not possible. It is not possible. They become very vulnerable. They become very vulnerable to the offers made by the accused and his parents or friends, etc. It's very difficult for them to withstand this. And there's always the fear of the parents that, oh God, now she's a rape victim. Now who is going to support her? Who's going to believe her? And the cases resulted in acquittal, etc. Many times the girls commit suicide after the incident of rape. They're not able to endure the social stigma that the incident of rape causes. The parents are always thinking that we want to send off this girl to the village and get her married. We don't want to go through this trial procedure, etc. But that cannot be. You can't leave this case halfway. And then the accused will come out on acquittal because the case was not proved successfully. You cannot, in one hand, ask for stringent punishment, hoping that it will be a deterrent. And at the other end, not bother about the trial court procedures, whether they are being followed and they're having the necessary impact on the people where it is supposed to impact. For instance, the defense lawyer who is in his 40s and 50s, an astute criminal lawyer, who is used to supporting criminals of various kinds. And here he is supporting this rape accused has every right to be represented by an astute criminal lawyer. I'm not on that. What I'm trying to say here is that facing him is this little child, who is about 8 years, 10 years, 12 years. The entire atmosphere is alien to her. And when she is facing this astute lawyer, there is nobody to hold a hand or stand beside her and to explain to her, the judge is for her, the public prosecutor is for her, we as support person are for her, and she need not fear. She need not answer looking at a defense lawyer. Her answers have to be addressed to the judge. She need not get afraid of him. He's only doing his job. And even when he asks humiliating questions, even when he asks repetitive questions to confuse her, where the entire process of defense questioning is in the line of tarnishing her moral character, her family's moral character, that she's a liar, she's used to sexual intercourse, or that she's a prostitute. In those moments, when she breaks down, if she's told you these are routine questions, you need not get upset about it. If you feel like crying, you may cry. There's no fault there. But you cannot allow yourself to go to pieces so that you are confused for the next question. He's doing his job. These are routine questions that he has to ask on behalf of his client, and he's doing his job. So if she understands this, then the questions will not shock her. If she's prepared to, she's prepared, she knows that these kind of questions are going to be asked to her, then the questions don't come they don't come as a deliberate attempt to tarnish her image. So this is how we provide protection, a sort of a protective shield around her, so that the trial becomes fair. Our main aim is that the trial should be fair. The child should be able to depose fearlessly. And the child should be able to depose truthfully and not turn the white into black or black into white just because of the skills of the defense lawyer. So this is how our program works. And this is how we are able to carry this out. And I hope this is very much needed. And I hope there are many people, many organizations who are willing to do this kind of work, which is something we all should be doing, rather than protest, rather than asking for changes in the law. We need to engage at a day-to-day level with the system of justice, so that it meets the demands that are made on. So I will now answer the questions if we have.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking your time from your busy schedule to talk to us. It was definitely an informative session. I'm sure there are a lot of things that we have learned and there are things that we have unlearned today. But with the end of this talk, I'm sure there are a lot of questions that are there in everyone's minds. So without any further delay, we shall move to the question answer session. If you have a question, please raise your hands on Zoom Cloud Meetings. Please raise your question by unmuting your mic. Raise your question and then unmute your microphone, and then only the moderator will take up the question, and they will be given time to facilitate better discussion. Please introduce yourself first before asking your question. In case of any technical issues, send your question via chat box. Those who wish to ask questions, please raise your hand. We'll now have the questions. First question is from Vibhuti Gupta. Vibhuti Gupta, please raise your question.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, you spoke about how a child is kept safe from collusion. But what if by some means she has been blackmailed? Then what are the different ways to get the child to speak the truth in the trial?
That is why the support person is necessary, you know? the support person is in touch with a girl. So when something like this happens, either her mother or she will inform the support person that this is happening, and then we can inform the police, and we can ensure that you know, this some kind of threat is minimized. If a guy is out on bail, we can move the court saying that bail should be cancelled because he's threatening the victim and her parents, or she has no security. The court will pass a protective order, either cancel bail or see that he doesn't come into her area, where her home is, her school is, etc. So that way we can protect. But if she's on her own and if she doesn't have a support person, then she becomes susceptible to all these kind of pressures around her. Now, I've not explained to you what happens when the accused person is the father of the girl. Can you imagine the pressure that goes on? Initial case is filed and the mother is supportive, but over the long period, when the father is not out on bail, he's incarcerated and he's the head of the family. He provides the economic support for the family. Everybody turns against this girl. And there's immense pressure for her to retract. And how does this pressure actually work out? It works out saying the father beat her because she was out late with her boyfriend. So to take out revenge on the father, she has filed this false case. This narration is there in every case, and this is the usual pattern that the defense lawyers use, so that the father comes off. Now, it is particularly disturbing when the child is about 13, 14, 15, 16, in this age group, and the judges seem to believe it. The judges seem to believe that, yeah, this girl must have filed a false case against her own father. And like a few years ago, the judges would not believe that the father is capable of raping his own daughter. But now the things are slightly changing. And now you can see that judges are also, because there's so much child sexual abuse issues in the public domain these days. And there was recently a child safety bill. There is more kind of some kind of belief that yeah, it can happen. And among the cases that we follow, around 18 point something cases are fathers raping their daughters. So there's a very high rate of the family member abusing the child, and this has increased during the lockdown period, and that is very sad thing. There are many cases that have come. Domestic violence has increased, and child abuse by fathers has increased during this lockdown period. So we have handled several cases of the fathers raping their daughters, and we have secured a conviction even in such cases.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is from Sehar Balla. Sehar Balla, please raise your question.
Good evening, ma'am. I'm Seher. Thank you for taking my question. I wanted to ask, you told us about how you introduced sort of like a support of literature for chaos, etc. What sort of updates do you think should be made to whatever requirements are there for judges? Because a biased judgment or an unfair judgment which portrays women as vamps or, you know, as immoral is not an isolated case in India. It's a very common norm, actually. So what sort of updates would you prioritize first?
Actually, there are judicial academies. There's a National Judicial Academy in Bhopal. There are also state academies, and one of the important subjects that's there in all trainings for judges is to examine rape cases, how the trial takes place, whether the judgment is as per, whether the trial judge has conducted the trial in a way that is sensitive to the child, in a way that as per the law, provisions of law, that are there in POCSO Act, for instance. So now when you read the judgment, in a case of acquittal, this bias has clearly come out. Well, they recorded over there. Something like past sexual history should not be an issue during the trial. The defense lawyers cannot ask questions on this. But it is very often allowed, and the judges hear arguments on this, that earlier she had a boyfriend, something else happened, and she's used to this kind of life, and this time she has accused this person. But she's used to like having many boyfriends, she's a woman of loose moral character. So that should not have been come for arguments at all, as per the law. You can very clearly see this judge has not followed the law, he has not understood the law. Sometimes it is the trial court and the case goes to high court. Sometimes it's the high court judge and the case goes to Supreme Court. So we have some very important cases where the Supreme Court has issued strictures against high court judges for making such comments. So when they come to the Judicial Academy, for instance, they go over these cases. Sometimes there's role playing, sometimes there is just discussing cases. They get an exposure. Many times people like us go there and give lectures. So one thinks that they get the sufficient exposure to understand what is a biased judgment, how that judgment ought to have been written actually. There's some exercises to rewrite a judgment which is biased. So Jindal Global or National Law University Delhi, there are projects of a women's project for rewriting judgments. So these kind of mechanisms, these kind of exercises happen not just at the National Judicial Academy but also at the state level. So otherwise they don't have the practice of reading judgment, analyzing them, etc. So this at this period when they come for these trainees, they get that exposure and also rewriting earlier judgment within our women's perspective or women's with a gender sensitive manner. So I'm not only talking about women, I'm talking about children. Many times there is like anal sex, T77 violations, the transgender people who are violated, there are all kinds of people. So when we offer support, we offer it to all people who need this kind of support and who are exposed to violence quite often in their lives. So that's how we try to change the perspective. How much these trainings work and how, to what extent their deep-seated biases change is very difficult to assess because it's very difficult to monitor the judges. And the High Court doesn't actually monitor the process of conducting a trial and arriving at a decision regarding the trial, because each judge is considered to be supreme in his or her own court. So that kind of judicial autonomy cannot be taken up by the higher authorities. You cannot monitor them. What you can monitor is only the judgments that come, particularly trial court judgments. The name of the judge and what the judgment has been written. And if you see many acquittals and same pattern being followed, then you know that this is the judge who's, and you can bring it up by all the supportive evidence of the judgments that the judges passed. Another point I want to say here is generally a belief that if it was a woman, the judgment would have been different. Women are like biologically more sensitive to repercussions, but that's not our age. That's not the experience that we have. We have very sensitive male judges. We have quite insensitive women judges having the worst kind of approach towards a rape victim. So I would not say this happens only on gender lines, the biological gender lines. Gender sensitivity has to be acquired. As a judge, you're not there to understand what this child is going through, what the child has been, the violation that the child has been subjected to. So you have to read some Supreme Court judgments that are extremely positive and be guided by those judgments. So when it happens at a judicial academy, One hopes that there is a change here. One hopes that some attitudes do get changed.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Siva Aishwarya. Siva Aishwarya, please raise your question.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
Aishwarya, I'm an industrial design second year student. So I want to ask about the rape culture, no? So is it influenced by the porn sites? In those sites, I can see, if we go and check those websites, it has some videos which is more like harassing and abusing women. How can we, everyone is having access, even children are having access to internet and all. So what is your opinion on that? And one question also, even boys are not safe.
I said that.
They are also,
I agree with you, boys are also not safe. And you have cases coming up where at a railway station, a runaway child who's sleeping at the station gets abused by an older boy who is also staying at the station. Or many of such cases that come, or between in a slum where very poor people live, and you find that the men have very easy access to small boys, etc. And generally, the police used to not take these cases seriously, but because we got the POCSO Act, which is a gender neutral law, which involves both men and boys and girls. So now there is a little bit of sensitivity regarding this. But your core question was the porn sites. Yeah, the porn sites. See, the rape has happened before the porn sites. There is a kind of a psyche that it's not just lust, but it is a power structure, the subordination, the subjugation of women to a sexual society. It has happened between communities. It has happened during the wars, because somewhere the notion is that the men of the community own the women. So the enemy, in order to humiliate the men, will rape the women. Now this has been a culture that is going on, has gone on. So I see rape as a manifestation of the hierarchy in society, the imbalanced power balance between men and women in our society, between vulnerable children and women in our society. And it is your women, you react differently. When it is the women of the other community, you react differently. So this has been happening. I'm not saying that porn sites are not contributing. I'm sure they are. And of course, now there is access even to small girl, children, and you have online classes, etc. So they have access to mobile phones, which the parents were restricting access before. But now it is widely used even for academic exercise, for conducting their classes, etc. And suddenly some porn site come and the children get glued to these images, etc. So that is a contributing factor. But at the same time, there is a freedom of expression, freedom of thought and expression. So people are entitled to express their views, their art, their creativity in various ways, including pornographical ways. So there is a feeling that if it is open, then the kind of titillating influence that it has, it will cease to have. If these images are widely there, as we see abroad, people kissing on the road, necking on the road, etc. Whereas here, ours is a very sort of cloistered society, and we are very much against expressing any sexual act or sexual feelings towards the other sex or towards the same sex also. And then you go to the porn sites, and that you use as a titillating thing, and then you try this out with the women that you have access to. So that is possible, but the government has tried many ways of curtailing access to these pornographic sites. At one time, like, you know, about 150, 200 sites were blocked by the government, which were considered as porn sites, etc. But there are a lot of groups which are opposing this government's arbitrary decision to ban these sites. Because this banning will not automatically stop the rape culture. So there are two views about it. And I do not know which is right. I have not done much work on this pornography images inside. But I feel that if it is more open society, the entire titillating effect of these porn images will diminish. It should not like excitement to such an extent if they see these images all the time. They see it on the road, they see it in the papers, they see it on this YouTube, you see it everywhere. So I don't think it will impact the rape culture. Because it is going backwards, I feel. We need to go forward, we need to deal with this. So banning is not an alternative. And I do not know how much of it is contributed to the porn site. Without the porn site, whether still this man would have raped this girl. Or girl. Or boy.
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Apurva Jain. Apurva Jain, please raise your question.
Hello, ma'am. I'm Apurva. I'm a final year student of law from Symbiosis Pune. Ma'am, I had a question about how queer people and their stories play into the rape culture and our conversations around it. I attended this other seminar and the host mentioned that the situation is particularly bad with transgender women and how every transgender woman has been raped at least once in their lifetime. Other than that, queer women, otherwise people assigned female at birth, often face corrective rape or forced marriages, which invariably result in that. And I feel like in a popular conversation around rape culture, it stays relatively heteronormative, and this part of the conversation is missing. What would you suggest are some social and legal changes that can sort of shift the conversation that way?
There is a viewpoint that rape laws should be gender neutral, but I don't subscribe to that because rape is very framed within a patriarchal mold, within a heteronormative mold, and often that men do for women. We need to broaden the parameters. We need to include transgender women, as long as they identify as women, come into the women category. And it is true that I've also had reason to meet several women who are like transgender women who have been raped. Raped by police, raped by gundas, raped by everybody, and a violent kind of rape at that. Many people have, in fact, confided in me that how much they have, where all they have been raped, and where the police have not taken seriously. And not just once, like it becomes a norm, it becomes a routine that they're raped. They also do sex work. And in the course of the sex work itself, many times, they are brutally raped. So, and for that, today we have only the weapon of 377, unnatural sex, to deal with it. They don't come within the purview of 375, 376. And hence the need was there to address it. But at the same time, as women's rights activists, many of us feel that the gendered structure of a rape offense will be lost if it has become gender neutral. There are a lot of discussions that are going on this, particularly for the LGBTQ community. And like there are trans women, there are trans men, there's the hijita community, the intersex people, there are like lesbians and gays, all these different kinds. and each one has a separate set of issues which need to be brought within the on the same canvas of discussion on rape law, and we need to find adequate answers how to deal with it, how to make people aware of it, how to curb police violence on trans women and sex workers. So there are many issues here, and interesting discussions are going on. I've not closely followed most of them, but at times I've been engaged with it, and I agree with you that yes, this is a very crucial, and there's a great void here, and we need to plug it in. And we also, like, rape happens within a heteronormative culture, so how do we take it out from this still retain rape and take it out of the heteronormative culture is something that I find very confusing, and I find confused. How do we frame it? How do we address it? But now 377 currently is being used, but we need to go beyond that, right?
Thank you, ma'am. Next question is by Aishwarya from NLU Delhi. Aishwarya, please raise your question.
I'm glad to see many law students here from different law universities.
Aishwarya, please unmute your mic and raise your question.
Yeah. Am I audible now? Hello?
Yes, you are audible.
Good evening, ma'am. My question is, what would be your advices or practical tips to young lawyers that they should keep in mind to make sure that there should be no gaps in the medical examination of the victim, and how the lawyer is supposed to deal with them? So basically gaps in the procedure of examination.
What do you mean by young lawyer? Where is the lawyer situated in this whole structure? I'm going to ask. And what capacity?
Sorry, ma'am, I didn't get your question properly.
See, there are different players in the rape trial.
Yes.
So this young lawyer, where is the lawyer situated in this structure?
So the prosecution.
The lawyer is a prosecutor or helping a prosecutor?
Yes, that's what I meant in the question.
Okay, because mainly the juniors would be helping a different defense lawyer, junior lawyers. Public prosecutor, to help the public prosecutor, you as a government employee, etc., you need a special permission to be there, because you don't have a place in the criminal trial as a junior lawyer, right, unless you appear for the state. If you are appearing privately, that means you are assisting the defense lawyer. So here, to be there in a criminal trial at all, one has to struggle very much to get that kind of a recognition or an appointment, as you have some locus standi to be there in the trial. Otherwise, you're not there in the trial. It took us a great effort to place ourselves within the criminal legal structure, and the enactment of FOXO Act, which really mentions the role of a support person, helped us to get that status. So I agree with you. Now this person may be working in an NGO like us, she wants to be a support person in a rape case, or she's working with a public prosecutor, she's got the permission to help a public prosecutor, etc. You need to look at all these kinds of structures. Now, once you do that, you have to understand the medical protocol that has been evolved, what a doctor is supposed to do. There's a checklist provided. Right. So that you have to be very familiar with. There's a checklist for everybody. For the police, there's a checklist. For medical, there is a checklist. For prosecutor, there's a checklist. So everybody's checklist, you have to be very familiar with. Once you're familiar with the medical checklist, and then you see the way the criminal, the medical examination was conducted, you can clearly see the gaps over there.
Hmm.
So if you see the gaps, it is your duty then to point it out to the public prosecutor, so the public prosecutor can raise it with the concerned hospital, concerned medical officer. So that's my first point. These are very, they're on the available on the internet. They're available everywhere. Everybody is aware of these medical protocols. And any doctor conducting a test in a rape trial has to be familiar with that. There are lots of trainings that have gone on to familiarize doctors about this medical protocol. Because a lot of cases used to fail because the medical examination was not conducted in the manner that is required to get a conviction. Now we have across all those barriers, there are many groups that work on it. Government has agreed on it, the health department has endorsed it, and they are available in the public domain. So you should look at them, familiarize, see each of them and see the test, look at the medical report, the charge sheet if it's fine. You'll get the entire medical reports and everything that the prosecution is relying on. And there you find a glaring fault. But by the time the papers come to you, it'll be too late. They will be already submitted in the court. The point of intervention is when the medical examination is going on before the charge is filed. And that is very difficult to get the document because you are no party at all. You have to ask the police, what we call an IO, the police officer who is investigating the case. He is supposed to have all the documents and the constable who is carrying these papers to and fro. From there, you have to get your papers, and that will happen only if you have certain status to ask for these papers from the police and look at this and point out the gaps to the IO that to see that this case you cannot get a conviction because these tests were not conducted, and he should ensure that they are conducted and these forms are filled correctly. Now that requires a lot of pushing and shoving and making your point, because nobody is taking this kindly. A young junior lawyer is coming and telling them what they should have done and they should have not done. They take extreme objection to this. You have to have some status to be there to ask these questions of them, and only then it will happen. So you have to struggle a lot, work with seniors, maybe work with an NGO who has this standing, and then it begins to move.
Thank you, ma'am. Is it fine if we take one last question, ma'am?
No problem.
Thank you. Next question, final question is by Apurva Jain. Apurva Jain, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, I had one last question about this recent conversation around decriminalization and or legalization of commercial sex work. Same goes for pornography. How do you believe that would change the rape culture that we have in our country? Do you believe that that would somehow start a conversation around consent or things like that? Or do you believe that the current situation of the rape culture is in the country and the current situation, the current conversation around sex that we have in our country, do you think this would further aggravate the situation, especially in the courts, where perhaps getting a conviction against a sex worker would be more difficult now that the person who has availed the services of the sex worker perhaps would not face as much stigma, or perhaps there'll be more backing towards the for the perpetrator in those cases?
There's a lot of rape that happens upon the sex worker, and there, of course, there is commercial sex is there, but also within that there is violations are there. There is gruesome injuries are caused, etc. Today, what happens is when they go to the police station, the police do not take him seriously at all. Counter to that, the police themselves may rape this woman, and this happens very often. Again, there are groups are working on it. There are sex worker collectives are there, and there is also a demand for not necessarily to allow commercial sex work, but it's more in terms of decriminalizing. Today, there is a lot of criminalization that happens. Any activity of soliciting, etc., all are viewed as a criminal activity. So what the sex worker collectives are saying is, we'll manage our lives, we just decriminalize it, so that we can avail of other protections. it will give us certain citizenship rights, certain benefits for healthcare, etc., that we very desperately need. Now, the change of attitude that came into the AIDS prevention campaign, because it was seen as sex workers hold the key, and if they are able to convince their clients to have safe sex, then that will be one point of preventing spread of AIDS in our society. Otherwise, before this, nobody was even looking at them. They were only looking at them as criminalized groups. But this has changed. Look, and condom distribution and all various lectures happened on AIDS prevention. And because they thought they would be the agents who are spreading this AIDS through their clients and through the clients, through the housewives. So that used to be a very big issue a few years ago, before this COVID scare and all came, in fact. So now, this is where we stand. This has been several debates, whether we need licensing, we need a sort of a registration, or we need just decriminalization. And sex workers collectives have opted for like decriminalization. If you decriminalize it, then things will improve for us. Right now, I don't know how far this debate has gone, but I believe, I agree with you completely that there's so much abuse, sexual abuse of sex workers that is going on, and the sex workers are very afraid to go and complain to a police. So they face a lot of abuse from the police themselves. So this, I dealt with this bar dancer issue. These girls who dance in the bars, and how the police were treating them, and what kind of sexual abuse they were subjected to by the police themselves. But otherwise, they say we can manage our lives, but it's the police harassment that we cannot bear. The police abuse, the harassment, the way we are locked up, etc. So it is a similar or even worse situation for sex workers. So that's how I know about this debate. That is, I guess the debate was like 10 years, 15 years old. But currently, I don't know where it has progressed, but I do not think of any efforts of any legal reform that's going on currently. I may be mistaken, but this is what I believe, that I don't think there is much debate happening right now.
With this, we now come to the end of this enlightening session. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such an enlightening talk. And I'm indeed sure we all learned and unlearned a lot of things tonight. On behalf of the entire Nauticoms team and participants, I take this opportunity to express a sincere gratitude to you, ma'am. Also thanking the entire participants who joined with us tonight to listen to and learn from ma'am.